This week's episode of Talking Simpsons is brought to you by Geek Fuel. Go to geekfuel.com/lasertime to sign up for a box of geeky goodies sent to you directly. And if you sign up through geekfuel.com/lasertime, you will get an exclusive Star Wars item worth $20 added to your first box.
Ahoy hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where maggots are our sheets and worms our blankets because we're in hell. This is the Laser Time Podcast Network's chronological Simpsons companion. I am your host, Bob Mackey, as always. Who else is here today?
Chris Santiston.
The hellbound Henry Gilbert.
Oh. And I'm Dave Rudden, carver of graven images.
Awesome.
I'm Antichrist Antista.
That's better. That's better. That's a Twitter name if there ever was one. And today's episode is all about Homer versus Lisa and the Eighth Commandment, which aired on February 7th, 1991. This is the whole stealing cable episode. But Chris, what happened on this air date in history, February 7th, 1991?
Make room for Danny Thomas is dead at 77. Whitney Houston's Super Bowl rendition of the Star-Spangled Banner is a hot radio demand. And Cher performs a one-night-only concert at the Mirage Casino. And George H.W. Bush swears to not bomb Iraqi schools and hospitals during the currently raging Gulf War.
What a stand-up guy.
I guess he didn't because we never went up. We never really went there.
Just had it if I could turn back time, baby.
Perfect.
I think there was an urban legend about Danny Thomas, who no one knows who that is, but...
Glass Top Table?
Exactly. Okay, the only reason I know about this is because it was a joke on Ren and Stimpy. But Danny Thomas apparently liked to sit under glass tables while sex workers would shit on them.
I thought that was like Chubby Checker or something.
Maybe it was just the common thing amongst the celebrities. But
it was absolutely a Danny Thomas thing. You might be thinking of Chuck Berry's love of farting on people.
Yeah.
And putting cameras
Maybe I am.
And putting cameras in bathrooms.
The fact that that's all I know about him really sucks for him, isn't it? Doesn't it?
He was also a musical
performer. That's his legacy.
Yeah.
He was in Make... I just remember Make Room for Danny or Daddy on Nick at Night. And I think the name switched back and forth. I can't remember. I grew up on Nick at Night. Sorry.
Yeah, so did I.
Speaking of cable.
Yes, this
episode...
And I want to start this off with... This episode explores the moral consequences of stealing cable. We are 25 years after this episode has aired. I do want to talk about the value of cable today. Here's what happened to me. Short story. My cable bill went up. I didn't know why. I called the cable company. They said, your bill will go down if you get internet and cable TV. So I only had internet before. Mm-hmm. So cable is worth negative dollars now. It actually, subscribing to cable may make cable bill go down.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Because they'd rather have the exact same thing happen to me too. Because they would rather have a subscriber for losing money so the subscriber numbers don't go down.
Exactly. That cable.
Our generation is cutting the cord, man.
It is. Cable is the new magazine.
Exactly. Okay, does everyone in this room still have cable? I want to know who has
I only
not...
have it because of that same deal.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Like
technically I do, but I never watch it.
I have not really watched cable outside of my parents' house since 2007, think. That cable box is still in my closet, like packed up in
I
a
never
way.
Watch it. We have standard definition cable.
Oh,
I
shit.
Never watch, yeah.
Yep, they sent me a box and there was no HDMI outport. It was like, here's
We've
your
never
com-
asked.
Composite.
We don't care.
Yeah.
Though, did any of you steal cable when you were younger?
No.
No, I think it was just you, Dave.
Just me and the... You're
one of those families, eh?
Yeah, the On the Lam Ruddens. I host a wrestling podcast, and a large part of that was that I had access to WWF and WCW shows for quite a number of years.
You watch pay-per-views all the time of that for free.
And now, I mean, everyone does because it's $10 a month.
Yeah. So I watched my first pay-per-view on a cable box.
So this episode is all about the magic of cable, this new entity that was actually probably 10, 12 years old by this point, maybe.
Yeah.
I think it was the late 70s, early 80s
thing.
Yeah, but
it's still in its infancy by all its descriptions.
It all
seems like huge parallels to internet content as it comes up. Because clearly people watch anything. Why don't we all play a video game and expect people to watch?
Exactly.
We'll make millions!
Well, a lot of this episode...
But can I play the biblical intro?
Yes.
I do love that.
Hey, good evening, Hezron, carver of graven images.
Ah, good evening, Homer the Thief. How is business?
Been a little slow these past few months. Not much to steal in the desert, you know.
Ah, do not worry, my friend. I figure we'll be wandering out here. Another 2 weeks, tops.
Hey, good evening, Zohar the adulterer. My wife sends her warmest regards.
Oh, yes. She's a good woman. Very good.
Thank you, my lusty friend.
But... Zohar in that scene is patterned after Jacques from the bowling episode.
He looks just like Jacques, but did Homer... Yeah, so Homer's always been a thief, I guess, is the thing. And
he's always been an urchin, a leech.
I didn't go to any church as a kid, so I didn't know this Exodus reference as a child.
I did, and then I love this. The first appearance of one of my favorite people ever, R.I.P. Phil Hartman, as Moses!
The Lord has handed down to us 10 commandments by which to live. I will now read them in no particular order. Thou shalt not make any graven images.
Oh, my God!
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Well, looks like the party's over.
I do like that I will read them in no particular order line because, like, there are only some of the commandments represented by people there, not all of them. So he has to do the ones represented by people.
And there's no...
And also the...
Bartholomew, head of coveting.
I think it was also a joke that he says, the guy who makes graven images that are things you put before God says, oh my God,
when he's told that.
I think that I missed that. Joe, and I don't think Hartman is doing... he can do a Charlton Heston, but I don't think that's his Heston.
It's not his Heston. It's weird.
Moses. This episode has so much Hartman.
I mean, he does Heston in the
no, he did it in
film, film festival.
In what?
In the Springfield film.
Yes.
Truly are the King of Kings.
Oh, right. That was
and
him,
he's played as Troy McClure played him in Planet of the Apes. And he played. I love that sketch because, oh, no, wait, that's regular Charlton Heston. It's Rob Schneider who does an awesome Edward G. Robinson.
I didn't know that.
Moses,
It's the first time I've ever heard awesome and Rob
it's
Schneider.
It's great. Like, Rob Schneider and SNL. Good shit. Is Peter Lorre for the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea sketch?
Oh, that's good.
Brilliant. Forgot about that. That was
good.
So,
20,000.
This was Homer's dream, and he is woken up by Flanders berating a cable guy, or rather, what is this guy's
cable
profession?
Guy.
Is he like a legit cable guy that will also sell you the fake stuff?
Having a
Not
super
the fake
story
stuff, like
from the Christmas
stuff.
Break... some guy came out to install cable in my sister's room who was recovering from an operation and he came out there. I don't have the right equipment. I have to come back another day because they won't let me work on it. And he comes back the next day and he drills and he has this guy with him. He's like, can we get the cable box? He's like, they closed out the order for that yesterday and you have to open up another order. And then eventually my dad wants to scream and I'm like, you know Comcast. Yeah. Oh, I just said their name. You know Comcast sucks. You know his life sucks. You know he's not making these decisions. And he eventually says, like, look, I don't work for Comcast. Yes, it says it on my shirts, my hat, and my pants. I'm a third party person. I don't have authority to do anything.
He has no loyalty either, right?
He has no loyalty
either.
So I'm betting we could have probably passed him some money like this fella.
Yeah, I should box your ears, you sneaky Pete.
Is it, Tiger?
Hey, you're busy. Now get off my property. Off.
Hey, Flanders. Who put that bug up your butt?
Oh, I wanted to subscribe to that new Arts and Crafts channel. Well, sir, they send over this flim-flam man to install it. You know what he did? He offered to hook me up illegally to every cable channel for only $50.
Boy, what's this world coming to?
You know, that's exactly what I...
Gotta go!
North by Northwest.
Stop!
What do you want?
I want free cable!
Weird that the Flanders is threatening violence.
Yeah. Well, he said box your ears.
It sounds violent, right? I have no idea what that is.
I don't either. I thought it was just slipping your ear.
Slap someone in the ear, maybe.
Something like that.
Think back to a time when I want one extra channel, so I will come here and turn a dial with my secret cable box.
Not to be overly boring about cable, it's just like the original cable line... was a vomit of every cable channel, and it was all about what Comcast installed in your house, and that's where it was blocked. So you can't do this today. You can't receive every cable channel. It's the idea that it was Comcast vomiting it out every channel, and some guy with his ass crack hanging out would figure out which to block by what connector.
Exactly.
Put in
your plugs. And now cable companies can tell your PS3, oh, don't play that.
Yes.
Or your computer,
which
like
mine does.
Exactly. And it's
you can't
funny.
Watch Fargo season.
You can't
two.
Watch that Oscar screener.
It's funny that 25 years later, this episode is asking us to sympathize with cable companies and to not want to steal from them when they are the worst entities ever, next to military contractors.
I believe that's in the pamphlet.
Oh, yeah. I believe that pamphlet.
It's okay, isn't it? I mean, everybody does it, right?
What? Oh, hey, if you're having second thoughts, just read this pamphlet.
Good old pamphlet.
So you've decided to steal cable.
Uh-huh.
Myth. Cable piracy is wrong. Fact. Cable companies are big, faceless corporations, which makes it okay.
I still pretty much believe this.
See, the clown is a treasure that will last a lifetime.
Cable.
And you get the
it's more wonderful than I dared hope.
Home Shopping Network.
Yeah.
You know that Home Shopping Network now is just for elderly people to have someone to talk to.
Yeah, I think so.
That's what it is. But I think multiple jokes in this episode are just a network TV show talking about how awful programming on cable is.
Exactly.
But it was.
Because they had no money. They didn't have original programming. Yeah. They just got stuff from Canada or Japan or Mexico.
I mean, a lot of cable is just, like, still is. Yeah. Just crap.
I feel like the early days of cable is what the internet is now.
Yes,
like, anything, just put anything out there.
Yes,
like,
one camera, forever and sit there and talk until we can figure out which awful of dating service to put a commercial
for. I've read books about the starting up of Nickelodeon and MTV.
Oh, the MTV one's great.
And they both were just like that. They're like, we're five dudes hired and getting paid no money. Let's figure out something to
introduce bite-sized content. No original content. Bite-sized content we license from other
and
people.
And that's how Mystery Science Theater was created. Yeah. It's like, we need something to fill time. This is cheap. And we own these movies.
Hours. This fills up two goddamn hours. So sure, let's do it. And I don't feel as strongly about this now, but I definitely feel like, oh, I'm ripping off a cable corporation. Who fucking cares?
Yeah, watch that 30 Rock episode where he reveals, like, we actually don't make anything. It's great. Oh, everybody else spends millions to make it. We don't do shit.
It's nice to be Cable Town.
Yes, Cable Town. But yes, it takes some convincing for the family. But Homer, I don't think if I would be this upfront with telling my family that I did steal cable.
They didn't need to know. I think Homer's going to be sleazy enough to steal. He should have just been like, okay, this just happened, and like, let's not talk about
now
it.
Now that I think about it, I might brag about how cheap I got something.
Oh, that's true.
That does
yeah.
seem like me.
Homer would be that, yeah.
And I guess Marge would notice because she says we can't afford cable. Yep.
Family, come here. I have an announcement to make. The Simpsons have cable!
Cable?
We have cable!
That's right, 68 channels, MTV for the kids, VH1 for us, 1,600 hours of quality programming every day!
Homer, we talked about cable before. You really think we can afford it?
Nothing a month? Yeah, I think we can swing that.
Are you sure this is legal?
Don't worry, Marge. Take a look at this.
It's only fair to pay for quality first-run movies. Fact, most movies shown on cable get 2 stars or less and are repeated ad nauseum.
Absolutely true.
Marge.
Hear me roar, the network for women.
In the next half hour, we'll show you how to cut your first aid bill in half by making your own Band-Aids.
That is what brings the family together in this scene.
Yeah.
Well, I did want to ask you guys, though, did you grow up before cable entered your household, and what was your reaction to when it happened? Because I remember...
Nickelodeon. It was a life changer.
I don't remember not having cable.
Me neither. Yeah, I hate to sound super privileged.
But,
but
since I've moved out, like moved to San Francisco, I did just get cable like last year because of that deal. But before then, it was like I'd spent like 4 years without cable because, I mean, most people were cutting their cable at that point anyway.
Yeah. We didn't have cable. I stole a black and white television because my parents didn't want me to have a TV in my room, and I would watch over-the-air channels.
Yeah.
I eventually unlocked cable for my whole house. That is a whole other escapade.
No, my childhood was... I'm sure I watched it in my parents' house, but I just remember that I had a babysitter because both my parents worked all day, but it was this woman who like babysat like a dozen kids around the neighborhood, and they had cable, and it was just so magical to be like, Nickelodeon, it's Nickelodeon time, yay!
Let's watch dreary British cartoons.
Yeah, or they had taped off HBO, The Last Dragon, which we watched 8 million times along with Dragnet. It was Dragon.
I never, I only had like the basic cable, so like mine
30
only
channels, maybe.
It went up to 29, which was MTV. I didn't get like I didn't get Cinemax, I didn't get HBO, didn't get any of those. Like everything had
MTV,
commercials on it.
Like, because MTV was controversial in the early 80s, that they hit it at the end of the cable dial.
You'll get too tired.
Mine was 36.
Wow.
36 was the end of the cable dial.
I think ours was 18, but I remember my sister, I was so jealous of her. She got to go to my grandma's to watch like Fraggle Rock and stuff. Like, I want to watch Fraggle Rock.
I wish I could recapture that magic TNT launching, because there was only TBS, and TBS was just like, we're just everything that's ever been on television, Ted Turner will buy the rights to and show here.
Oh, yeah. 5 minutes later,
old sitcoms and old cartoons early in the morning, and then they marketed TNT as in like it was all King Kong footage, and they bought that Muppet who'd create the explosions to yell TNT, and they were because Fraggle Rock was cordoned off to HBO. I'd have to watch it at friends' houses, and Muppet Show. So that was like all TNT was. It was like an all Muppet and cartoon channel during the early mornings. And great.
Cable definitely shaped my love of things as a kid. Not just the later original stuff like say Nicktoons, but I would watch pro wrestling because that was also easy filler on cable. Oh, like,
Make a Sentence had that too.
El Mumeo lo pone en el sleeper hold. ¿Dónde están los médicos de México?
Ooh, pro wrestling from Mexico. You know, down there, it's a real sport.
Misters.
Not true.
Man, Phil Hartman really is getting a lot of mileage in this episode.
He's here's him on CNBC.
Mr. Speaker, if I could call your attention to the retroactive subsidy appropriations override bill, I refer you to page 4,500.
They must think people will watch anything.
Live from New Orleans, this is the World Series of Cockfighting.
My parents had to explain to me what cockfighting was. And,
did you cut out? Oh boy, we're going to have big fun on the bayou tonight.
A lot of this episode is characters watching TV, and that is something Matt Groening's obsessed with. Like, he says he first saw it on 101 Dalmatians, like the Dalmatians watching TV, and that made him excited. Like, you can have a cartoon character watch TV, so that's why The Simpsons watch TV a lot, because Matt Groening thinks it's a fun idea.
That is the first Disney movie with television in it.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah. And they would later reference that exact scene with the Greyhounds.
Oh, right, yeah.
Get
Model
down,
Zinc.
You.
Well, and then we go to church. But by the way, the shot when they peel Homer out of the couch, they linger on it for like 3 seconds too long.
Yeah, it's holds
like,
a little much.
Yeah, I get it. He left an indention. He'd been in it that long. So then it comes to the other thing we are sick of in our lives now. Religion. Yeah. Cable and religion. Got no time for it.
During all of this, the emblem on Reverend Lovejoy's podium and one of the commandments is basically the Twitter logo in color.
Oh, yeah.
It's blue and white and a bird. But they have to they explain to Bart and Lisa what hell is.
Now, I don't want you to get frightened, but it's my responsibility to teach you this. Today's topic will be hell.
Oh, all right. I've sat through mercy and I've sat through forgiveness. Finally, we get to the good stuff.
Oh, hell is a terrible place. Maggots are your sheet, worms your blanket. There's a lake of fire burning with sulfur. You'll be tormented day and night forever and ever. As a matter of fact, if you actually saw hell, you'd be so frightened you would die.
Oh, Miss Albright.
Yes, Bart.
That's
wouldn't
name.
You eventually get used to it, like in a hot tub?
No.
yes,
Bart.
Are there pirates in hell?
Yes, thousands of them.
Oh, baby.
So excited. He's been to hell, though. I mean, come on. He went to hell and Bart gets hit by a car.
Listen to heavy metal music.
I definitely had this moment as a kid, too, of I never went to church except I had a friend who, for about a year, I would go with him to, like, after-school Catholic stuff because... My friend's gone. I want to keep hanging out with my friend. I'll go with him to after school.
Nintendos and free snacks. That's what the church was littered with.
Well, mine was... It was more of an old school Catholic thing, but it was definitely where I first got introduced the idea of hell. And it is terrifying to a kid because you fucking believe it. Yeah. Like, you take it at face value.
Kids really are not equipped to handle that idea.
It feels borderline child abuse to tell the kids this, but it also is an easy way to just keep a kid in line. Like, you're going to go to hell. Like, you better not do this stuff. But... I also think in at least the southern churches I've been to, they would not point you to something Old Testament like the Ten Commandments. They would say, and Jesus. And they'd make you like accept Jesus as your Lord and you'd be baptized or whatever. Mm. It would go back to Jesus. It would not go back to Old Testament.
They don't want to acknowledge that?
Well, it's just not as important as Christ. Christ is number one.
Yeah, this is where Lisa gets her first like taste of fear.
Yeah.
It's hard to tell like because it's in this kind of era where they don't want to make a statement about anything. So I'm not sure if Lisa's taking it too seriously or the show is siding with her because I feel like she's a little too harsh with her family about this, including a scene much later.
Also, it's weird that Lisa's so religious.
Yeah, it's like
she's the smart one, so you'd think she would be skeptical about this.
Exactly.
Kind of thing.
I mean, by the time we get to the angel skeleton, we'll get her being the one who believes in nothing.
Yeah. Meanwhile, and somewhere in between there is I'm calling this the line of the show.
That's the joke.
So, what did you children learn about today?
Twist their mouth.
Hell. Well, that's what we learned about. I sure as hell can't tell you we learned about hell unless I say hell, can I?
The lad has a point.
Hell, yes.
Bart!
Hell, 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 hell.
Bart, you're no longer in Sunday school. Don't swear.
I love it.
Is this the most Twister Mouthiest scene?
Yes, I think
ever.
So. Like ever
we discussed
animated.
Twister Mouth already?
We have. Yeah, okay. It's like when the head like twists past the jaw.
If you watch it, the eyes and mouth are in the
like
same
only the kids do it though.
I think I've only seen the kids do it.
Burns did it once.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, but
it's pretty much only do it with Bart.
Bart, because his head is just like a weird tuna can kind of thing.
Yeah, and it was just one of those little visual flourishes they don't do anymore. And then They get home, and who's on TV?
Dad, are you sure this isn't stealing?
Read the pamphlet, honey.
Hello, I'm Troy McClure.
Yeah.
You may remember me from such movies as Cry Yuma and Here Comes the Coast Guard. But today I'd like to talk to you about a pleasant-tasting candy that actually cleans and straightens your teeth.
Oh, goody, a program-linked advertisement.
Wait a minute, Troy. I'm a little confused. Did you say cleans and straightens?
There's no confusion, Tina. Just good science.
I love that.
So, Troy McClure, the character, is a combination of Troy Donahue and Doug McClure.
Yeah.
Two actors of a certain era that never did much. They weren't important or well remembered.
Forgot about what's the first actor?
Troy Donahue.
Because I went looking all over the net for clips of Doug McClure, and like his hair is spot on. His hair is absolutely spot on, but like I have a clip of Doug McClure. McClure lines, you will hear no Troy McClure in it.
Well, I sure hate to admit it, but I guess Kelly was right. He said you were too much of a tomboy to let me kiss you.
Oh, he did he?
Yes, he did.
Make it 10 and you've got a deal.
10? 10.
That's a very attractive Mary Tyler Moore.
You can't hear any of Troy McClure and Doug McClure.
No.
Because I think he was still alive to be reminded by his loved ones that Simpsons is making fun of you.
There's a story on the commentary that he was a watcher of The Simpsons, and then he realized they were mocking him. But he was okay with it, and his kids have told, apparently, Mike Reese, one of the producers on the show, that they would call him Troy McClure behind his back.
Mm, that's awesome.
Goof on him. But yeah, the Troy McClure is perfectly just the, I was a B-movie actor in the 50s. I am meaningless now and uncastable. I guess I will host whatever you pay me to do.
Who would be our generation's Troy McClure? Like someone we grew up with who is now just like
Richard Grieco.
Cashing checks. Maybe like, God, what's his name?
Like anybody who's
Ray Liotta.
I have it actually.
Who is it?
I think it might be Snoop Dogg.
I think
anybody who's hosted Family Feud is in that position. Where it's like, remember when you were comedian and/or actor?
I would say Steve Harvey when was the last time he's been noted for doing stand-up?
Yeah,
embarrassing himself on regular television. That's what he does.
But I miss Troy McClure so much.
Oh, God, me too.
There are fewer things that make me happier than reading a compiled list of everything Troy McClure has ever done.
Yeah.
And you can hear Phil Hartman's voice when you're reading
every
that
time. Yeah. And if you, it, the only way you can have more fun, and I did this with the Kirby anime. If you go and read the English translations as Troy McClure, it'll give you the same kind of thrill. Snacky happiness. It's time.
But and Troy is perfect from the first moment.
Yeah.
I
was looking into it. Apparently, he's voiced by Dan Castellaneta at some point when Phil Hartman is out.
Like, it's the next episode we're doing, actually.
Yeah.
Because they recycle this animation, I believe.
Yeah.
They just have him say it. Oh, yeah, I need my teeth to look their whitest.
You were saying about Lisa being too hard up and too moral. I absolutely love... It's another one of Hank Azaria's blue-collar guys.
All right.
And Marge is testing grapes.
Was this guy, like, shipped in from Staten Island or something? Like, hey, lady, I'm just trying to do my job over here.
The pet store guy, any driver, they all have this accent from Hank Azaria.
I have to say, this episode did negatively affect me. Anytime I went to a supermarket afterwards, I would take, like, a couple grapes, because it's like, no.
I never knew you could do that until the show. Don't you think it's weird, though? Lisa has the amazing vision of hell surrounding them. Also, Dr. Nick, it was the first, Hi, Dr. Nick.
And
Dr. Nick had gone from being a guy who faked injuries to inventing corrective gum.
That's brilliant.
I will tell you about the story of grocery store corruption.
Oh,
when I worked in the grocery store 15 years ago, I don't think you can arrest me now because it's been so long, but everyone there just always stole food. No one paid for any food. Anytime you ate food at the grocery store, you just took it off the shelf, took it to the break room, and ate it. So, like, stealing was rampant and no one cared. It was just like you figured out everyone was stealing and you did it yourself. So, like, that was part of, like, the fabric of grocery store
workers.
I feel
like an asshole because I worked at McDonald's and, like, a DVD retailer, and I never stole shit. All because I was too afraid because I'd been arrested for stealing before.
That'll do it.
What is up, Talking Simpsons fans? Chris here. Briefly jumping in to tell you this show is brought to you by Geek Fuel. And if you go to geekfuel.com/lasertime right now, you can get a free Star Wars item worth $20 just for signing up for a mystery box. So what's in the mystery box, you ask? 6 to 8 items, an exclusive t-shirt, and a $50 value of Kit and Caboodle featuring famous stuff from Marvel, DC, Nintendo, Zelda, Game of Thrones, Pop Figs, pint glasses, posters. You never know quite what it's going to be, but it's like a delicious, geeky gift that shows up at your door whenever you feel like it. And oh, guess what? They've had Simpsons stuff involved in the box in the past. So go to geekfuel.com/lasertime right now. Sign up for one of their boxes. Get it as a gift for a geek in your life and get a free $20 Star Wars item right now.
I think it's weird. Lisa sees the same devil that Bart saw. Like, yes. It is the same. It I is like the consistency. Devil. Yeah.
I like the consistency, but price check on two.
Anything else?
Yes, I ate two grapes. Please charge me for them.
Oh, two grapes? Who cares?
Just charge me something, please.
Yeah, okay, all right. I need a price check on two grapes. Yeah, you heard me, Phil. Two measly stinking grapes.
He's almost at the Charles Bronson, but like a little more aggro.
Yeah.
Two grapes. Who cares?
Another thing I loved, the making fun of HBO, and at some point, just Bart adorably referring to John McClane as Die Hard.
Yeah.
All right.
Yes.
Die Hard, Wall Street, and what was the other one?
Well, Jaws.
Yeah.
Jaws. Yeah, but referring to Bruce Willis as Die Hard. Yeah. What a great name for a character.
Why can't Metroid crawl?
But the Blockbuster Channel.
So if you didn't catch it in the theater, or read it, or see it someplace else, we've got it on the Blockbuster Channel.
That was very much what HBO was. Yeah. It's like, we have the movie a year later, we will run it 3,000 times.
And the comment about every cable movie gets 2 stars or less. Yeah. And like, because if movies were very popular, they didn't hit HBO. They would stay in theaters or go to the rental market.
I saw Spaceballs roughly 800 times on HBO.
Good
that's
God,
where I saw it.
Yes. Oh my
every
God.
Day, I think I watched Spaceballs for like a year.
I'm seeing on Homer's side now, like, oh great, she heard about hell for the first time or the Ten Commandments, so she's seeing everything in super strict black and white. That's not the real reality, but I have to humor her slightly.
Yeah.
But it's just, it would get annoying. Like,
there's a scene where Homer is trying to coax Lisa over to cable stealing, and he's like, oh, look, there's a horse race. You like ponies. Yeah. And she says, sorry, I'd rather go to heaven.
I'd rather
I'm like,
go to heaven.
Damn, Lisa. Like, they don't address that at all. She's being way too harsh with her family.
And Homer still puts his foot down.
There's something wrong with that kid. She's so moral. Why can't she be more like, well, not like Bart, but there's got to be a happy medium.
Well, you know, Bart was looking at that racy movie today, and Lisa's losing a little respect for you. Maybe we should think about unhooking the cable.
Unhook it? But I love cable!
Well, then maybe you should pay for it.
Don't, look, Marge, this I can't argument. Afford it. When I can afford to pay for it, I will. But I can't, so I'm not going to.
Homer, I'm afraid that cable has become an evil presence in our home.
Marge? I never put my foot down about anything, but I am severely tempted to do it over this.
Oh, Homer.
Marge, I'm sorry. I think it's coming down.
No, Homer,
it's
not
coming down. My
no,
foot.
No.
That's it, Marge. It's coming down. The cable stays. The foot is broken.
You can always tell when they're recording together. Sounds so much better.
That argument justifies all media theft ever since the internet was invented.
Not just media theft. Like, no offense to people who find causes important on the internet, but you'll notice how they all revolve around the things they like to watch, read, and play.
Yeah.
And that I am the exact same way. I will not take a stance over anything unless it's something the equivalent of cable television.
It's not my distraction.
Yeah.
Like, I'm with that too. All right.
What about politics? Oh, I didn't vote, and I don't read the paper, and I have no idea what's happening.
So we should say that Bart was caught watching a dirty movie on the Top Hat Network, which is not available in Utah or Florida.
Love that joke. Yeah. I get that joke way more now.
Adult you guys are Floridians.
Top Hat Entertainment. Adult programming all day, every day, except in Florida and Utah. Coming up next, Stardust Memories.
So,
is it a Woody Allen movie?
Yes.
And we also have broadcast news.
I love the... it's a little bit too real. Bart switching away from pornography.
That is exactly.
Ay, caramba.
Bart!
Dad! Oh, here's what I was looking for.
Blue chips closed up 3 3/4.
It taught me a strategy for later in life.
Got caught masturbating in my dorm room in college and switched immediately, like... Look how far this person can dive without breathing.
Later be my strategy to like, okay, when I press stop on this VHS, let me make sure it's a channel that people would expect me to watch.
I remember some remotes had like a previous channel button.
Oh, exactly.
So,
we're all talking about masturbating, by the way.
Top Hat, I guess, is Cinemax.
No, it's probably Playboy Channel.
All right. I just... I don't know. For me, mentally, I can't imagine Bart seeing hardcore porn. I have
it
to think
well,
it's softcore.
At this point, Playboy was not showing penetration or
anything. Oh, okay,
like that.
That's
even
true.
As a kid, though,
yeah.
softcore was like mind
blowing.
Didn't
know what
yeah.
the fuck it was. Like, you're seeing boobs do things.
And didn't have the internet.
Stuff.
Like, it was
yeah.
like, yeah.
This is what pornography was before the internet, people. Yeah.
I remember when I took a picture of it at some point, but like going back to my parents' house, they have regular cable, but like the porn channels have gone insane, and the description is.
Gross.
It's like, really weird. Yeah. It's Mammary Mama. It's like totally unsafe for children in the language of just the titling. And it's
the
right
title
there.
Is like nine words usually. Yeah. Like yeah.
it's well, like devastating lesbians.
Kids yeah. can see porn. Like I,
it's true.
I don't know what it'd be like to be a parent today. Of just like
oh,
once
Jesus
they're
Christ.
Once they're eight, you're like I know you can see. You've probably seen yeah. hardcore pornography. Like not that you wanted to or even sought it out, but. Mm-hmm. Amy Poehler has the hilarious bit in her book talking about how a friend of hers. Their child had searched naked body or just naked on Google, and one of the first image results was a woman with asparagus shoved in her ass.
Wow. That's like, he's, what's the SEO on that?
She said, how are we ever going to get him to eat his vegetables now?
So the driver
is here.
Oh,
I was watching Futurama, and I had the picture of it here. It's Futurama just scrolling down beyond the channels, and it's finger banging moms penetrated.
Wow.
It's just right there on the cable list.
Like SEO and not actual title.
Exactly.
Like
I just happened to get a nice picture of all the Futurama crew looking down.
They're disappointed.
This is another thing. Back then, it was about parodies or things called like bikini whatever. Yes. You'd have bikini in the title, but now there's just no... like this. Like, we got to tell you exactly what you're
it's
seeing.
It's just here. Sex. That's
yeah.
it.
Yes.
Yeah. So the driving thrust of this, it's a lot of characters watching TV, but there's an important event in this. So this is the Tatum-Watson fight. And we first meet Frederick Tatum.
Frederick Tatum.
Oh, Frederick. Yeah, not Frederick. Sorry.
Another tie for my favorite line of the show, describing
yeah.
him.
The challenger learned how to fight in the notorious projects of Capital City and honed his skills while serving time for aggravated assault and manslaughter in Springfield Prison.
All right, a local boy!
Do you have a Tatum Watson interview showdown?
No,
thing? That's my favorite quote of the show is.
You can't do that,
Joe. I would also like to dedicate this message to C-Smanage.
So the life of Frederick Tatum, is Mike Tyson
yes, to a T,
sure.
yeah,
to the T of Tyson and Tatum. Yeah,
is this his first appearance or is it in the
his
last season?
His absolute first appearance.
Okay.
Yeah. yeah, but that. So I did a little extra digging into this. I think this is very specifically supposed to be Evander Holyfield versus Mike Tyson because there was no bigger super fight that could happen in the early 90s, late 80s and that. If you watch, there's actually an amazing documentary
Chasing
on
Tyson.
Netflix called
Great.
Chasing Tyson because Holyfield was seen as the next Tyson challenger. And if you only know Mike Tyson as a joke who stars in an Adult Swim cartoon who also went to jail for horrible things,
well,
then, you don't know that he was also the most dominant boxer ever of all time.
At
like,
an extremely young age, too.
That he came up and his matches like... a second round was rare. Yeah. Nobody fought on that level before.
And that documentary is so depressing because Evander Holyfield, here's a good role model, a great boxer.
Yeah.
All he has to do is fight Tyson to validate him in the public. And Tyson's like, yeah, I'm going to go to jail for 4 years.
Yeah.
So he never gets the validation.
At this point in time, in February of 91, Tyson in 89, at the end of 89 or at the very beginning of 90, I forget, he loses to Buster Douglas in the upset of the century in Japan. Then he's starting to rebuild, but Holyfield got the title. And so now they're trying to build to Holyfield Tyson at the end of 1991. In November 1991, Tyson would later go to jail for that, go to jail for rape.
Yes.
And would spend 4 years in jail. And it's also interesting that the life of Frederick Tatum, though not with rape involved, does mirror every time they check in with Frederick Tatum. Like when he comes back to fight Homer,
He has his own Don King.
Yeah, he looks just like him too.
So that's a question I have in this episode because there is a Don King like character, but is it Don King or Lucius Sweet? Because as they say, he is exactly as rich and as famous as Don King.
I guess
it's Lucius Sweet, but so this is. Either Showtime or HBO, they were the big boxing networks. It's where you'd go. Back then, they wouldn't air it on HBO for a fight that big. You'd have to pay $100.
Some Tyson fights were on like Showtime.
Okay, that's true. Sometimes, but anyway, so that's the background there. You didn't see so much of Watson after this. Also, spoiler for later in the episode. As far as the Simpsons are concerned. Tyson would have beaten Holyfield in a barn burner of a match But Tyson would have won.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Watson's facial hair does match up with Holyfield.
Okay.
So, yeah. Totally. And his hair, but I got to get back just because Homer wants to have everybody over to watch the fight. I just watched the new Netflix cartoon, F is for Family, the Bill Burr show.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like the plot of the first episode, too. Like,
oh, really?
I think just saying like what a big deal that used to be and how hard it was to see these fights unless you paid top dollar to watch them live. And people would get so excited to come over to your house, but it escalates because Burns decides to come over.
Exactly.
And I love this Smithers interaction at the end.
He's Homer Simpson, sir, one of your drones from Sector 7G.
Excellent. Yeah. I'm so keen on seeing Watson versus Tatum 2, I'd even go to an employee's house. Oh, I can picture it now. The screen door resting off its filthy hinges, mangy dogs staggering about, looking vainly for a place to die.
Permission to speak frankly, sir?
Permission granted.
Well, you are quite wealthy.
Thank you, Smithers. Your candor is most refreshing.
No, I mean, why don't you pay for the fight yourself?
Ah, Smithers, a big title fight is one of those rare occasions that I savor the sights, the sounds, and, yes, the smells of other men.
You haven't lost the common touch, sir.
That was the perfect moment for a Smithers' gay joke, and he just doesn't make it.
You haven't lost the touch? He's kind of saying we have this in common.
Did you also, I didn't notice this as a kid, but like Burns has a camera in the shower.
Yeah, he's
like,
overhearing.
He watches them. Yeah, that he's taping them nude every day. And they don't have much the showers at the nuclear power plant only ever come back when, for a one-off joke, when Homer's drawing them in the showers when he becomes an artist.
I think that was mom and pop art.
Not a great episode.
One of my favorite throwaway lines is in that shower scene where like they're talking about the fights and they're all cheering Homer, and then he says, "Pass the pumice, please."
Homer using a pumice stone is hilarious.
I forgot that.
Yeah.
But they would have like fancy shower objects in that.
I'm sorry for skipping all over the place with my clips, but like Homer finally relents to Lisa. And to not watch the end of the fight. We can fill in the gaps whenever we want. We're going a little long.
This episode's kind of aimless, too. It just has a lot of stuff happening.
Excuse me. I hate to interrupt your judging me, but I wanted you to know I've made a couple of really important decisions. Number one, I'm cutting the cable as soon as the fight's over. And number two, I'm not very fond of any of you.
Huh? Well, back to the fight.
Get on, boy.
Dad, we may have saved your soul.
Yeah, the worst possible
all this
time.
Other shit. He's going to jail.
I like that Homer is not happy about learning his lesson.
No.
He's mad about it.
Yeah. No.
And this fight seems like the greatest fight ever. According to the announcer, it ends in round 12. So I don't know how long those people were sitting inside their house.
And one of the guys sitting inside is the guy you fight in the arcade game.
Exactly. I noticed that this morning.
That's the only time I've seen him, I think, on a show.
The drunk at the end of the Moe's fight.
Giant guy. He's sitting, who looks like a neo-Nazi.
He does, yeah.
He's sitting on the floor cheering.
He looks like Mr. Burns and Moe's love child, but I think they just pulled him as a background character for a boss, because like, this guy looks evil. Yeah. Like, he looks like, why is he in their house?
So as a child, I had two, I immediately had my nerdy continuity-ness, the questioning even came in then. First, before Smithers says it, I was like, Burns can afford cable himself. But then the second one was, right, when Homer is buying all the bars and security stuff for his house, I was like, as a child, I even said, you could afford cable. Those those cost you hundreds of dollars.
I also like he went to the Quickie Mart and bought Crato Duff.
Yeah.
And there's a sign in the background that just says, eat more often.
So, and there's jokes, they mention this on the commentary too, but you notice it that the joke is that it's weird they would invite Apu there, which is because, like, why would you invite the guy who runs a 7-Eleven to hang out at your house?
And now they've had his wedding in their backyard.
He has his wedding backyard. Yeah. In just 3 years, he would live on their couch while after getting fired by the Quickie Mart.
By the way, I looked at it. The Crate of Duff is 24 beers. I don't know if they had fewer beers and packages back then. You can get beer in 30 packs now.
Yeah.
Wow. So they were stronger, but I have no idea.
And Apu mentioned Sanjay, though we don't see him. Though it is the first
mention. He deplores violence of any kind.
He deplores violence of any kind. It feels almost racist to do an Apu.
All right. Stupid outside research I did. The fight ends. Homer's and the family are watching it outside. And it's the greatest fight ever by description of the characters.
Yeah. Right. The greatest fight ever, and I missed it.
We're really proud of you, Dad.
What a Donnybrook, eh, Mr. Bunn?
Oh, hogwash. Why, I once watched Gentlemen Jim Corbett fight an Eskimo fellow bare-knuckled for 113 rounds.
Back then, of course, if a fight lasted less than 50 rounds, we demanded our nickel back.
Is that where the name of the band comes from?
Nickelback.
Oh, God. I don't want to share anything in common with the people in Nickelback, including Simpsons fandom.
So did you guys do research on General Jim Corbett?
Yes, I did.
I did, too. What did you say?
He fought his last match in 1903.
Wow.
Which in 1991 would make Burns 100 years old.
Yeah. Once again, make him 100 years old. But that's how fucking awesome the references are.
I feel like this entire show was written to get to that joke. You know, like, that's my joke of the show.
And he wrote an autobiography, starred in a Broadway production about himself that was eventually made into a 1942 Hollywood movie called Gentleman Jim, starring Errol Flynn as Gentleman Jim Corbett.
Oh, wow. Well, I also was thinking about Burns' relationships in this episode. One, he's talking with Apu, which is crazy at that point to think the super rich guy is having a conversation with the 7-Eleven employee. Secondly, that they wouldn't really... The only next time I can think of them hanging out is in the Pin Pals episode when they're on Homer's bowling league.
Aren't they all going back to the Quickie Mart for slushies and burritos? Yeah.
And burritos. And then also, Burns is on the couch with Abe Simpson. They don't know each other at this point, apparently, but they served together in World War II on the Fighting Hellfish.
That's right.
You think Abe or Burns, like, I guess they don't have great memories, so maybe
that's that generation, Henry. They don't like talking about it.
I mean, we also have the joke where Barney opens the door and Burns thinks it's Homer.
I love that joke so much. Because Barney just stands there.
Yeah, just like vacant, like the vacant expression. God, and then Homer just pops in front of him.
All the stolen things from work, too. Yeah.
Speaking of vacant expressions, every time Lisa is staring at Homer in this scene, it's kind of haunting.
It is creepy,
because he just turns around, she's there staring at him judgingly. Love it. Love it so much. And Homer eventually cuts the cable, and I think that joke is great. Doesn't work well in audio, but the ending of the episode is awesome. But
I laughed really
I like that he does more damage to the world by going back on this thing. Yeah,
and but Bart pleading with him, I think, is the writer's damning. Yeah. How shitty early cable was.
Oh, for sure.
I beg you to reconsider. Tractor pulls, Atlanta Braves baseball, Joe Franklin.
And Joe Franklin is interviewing Krusty for like 3 seconds as they're flipping through channels on this episode.
So, all right, the things here.
That was all cable was.
In case you didn't know, the tractor pulls, I don't have a specific thing for that. Atlanta Braves baseball was not a great team in the early 90s, though. They became an amazing team.
This was like at the end of their futility.
But the other thing was, they were owned by Ted Turner. They played on Turner Field, owned Turner Broadcasting Simpsons.
Who turned his WTBS Atlanta station into a worldwide cable channel. So whereas you would only be able to see like your local baseball team playing a network in your territory, the whole world had to endure Atlanta Braves baseball.
Yeah, well, it's the same if you watch WGN, you get the Cubs.
You see the Cubs and White Sox.
But that's not how it is now, but so you get a ton of baseball. Meanwhile, Joe Franklin was a talk show host for 43 years, only for the local New York area, but the New York channel he was on, WOR, also went on to early cable, though. I never had that channel as a kid.
Because I've never listened to Howard Stern, but read his biography, and he's like, I had this talk show that was seen everywhere. I'm like, I've never heard of it, never seen it, and I think it was on WOR.
That's probably right.
So, that Joe Franklin, I never saw
who
Joe
also
Franklin
raped
until
Sarah Silverman, according to the Aristocrats.
In the Aristocats.
Oh, right, that's right,
But, and he was one of the first guests on the Space Ghost Coast to Coast. That's how I first got to see Joe Franklin.
I get him and Dick Cavett confused. And like, because even I brought up both of them in front of my dad, and he's like, oh, fuck those guys. He grew up with them on television constantly.
And Joe Franklin died a year ago, in January of 2015. At the age of 88.
We're saying it's okay if you don't know who Joe Franklin
is. Yeah, you don't need to. Think of Larry King and think of a slightly worse Larry King.
A shorter, fatter Larry King.
Well, that was Talking Simpsons, everybody.
Joe Franklin!
We're glad we're here to explain Joe Franklin to everybody, because I think we're doing a service to younger people.
This is such a dated episode, really. Nobody has other screens to stare at. All you have is cable to look at, which felt so magical then. You don't even know it now.
And content has no value, basically. Like, only
like
specialized.
Now.
Hey, this content has value.
Thanks for listening.
Yes. Yeah. Wow. Almost damn myself. Yes, that was Talking Simpsons. I'm Bob Mackey, your host. Find me on Twitter as Bob Servo, and also check out Retronauts, my classic gaming podcast. Go to retronauts.com or usgamer.net, or search for it in all of your fun podcast software.
and Chris Antista. We host a bunch of us host the Laser Time Show. That's a weekly pop culture show focused on one topic, unlike 302010, which is focused on, if you like the news intro we do at the beginning of this show, it's like a whole show about that for 10 years ago, 20 years ago, and 30 years ago. So it's called 302010.
Amazing, but all worth listening to, just like my podcast, Cape Crisis, where we talk about the regular weekly events in the world of comic books. And also there's Video Game Apocalypse, the video game show done every week on this network as well.
And I host Cheap Popcast, the wrestling podcast that includes all wrestling, even wrestling in Mexico, where it's for real.
Wow, cool.
And don't forget, too, if you've never heard the first season of this, Talking Simpsons, that's available to patrons of patreon.com/lasertime. You get $5 or more a month, and you can download the first 13 episodes.
I support this event or product. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next week, everybody.
Wow. Infotainment.